Chris Sanders, I'm the lead investigator for this incident. I am one of the two coordinators for the Berrien County Homicide Task Force. Also with me today is the other coordinator of the Berrien County Task Force, Homicide Task Force, Detective Sergeant Fabian Suarez of the Michigan State Police. The Berrien County Homicide Task Force is made up of investigators from agencies across Berrien County, and there were a number of agencies that assisted us with this investigation. It was a team effort, and I'll explain a little more on that later. I want to point out a couple things. This is an active investigation. We're currently going over statements, analyzing videos, audio, working with the crime lab and the medical examiner's office to obtain a complete picture of what had gone on.
Sir, I'm so sorry. Is there any way you could sit by? We're having trouble picking up the sound. If you pull up the chair, could you sit by me? I just want to.
Well, I think unfortunately, I'm during the presentation going to be required to move around a little, so we aren't going to get me like in one spot, unfortunately. What I'm here to do is provide you with a summary timeline of events that occurred on July 11th, 2016 at the courthouse. This is based off information we have at this time. I have to caution you that as we continue with this investigation, that information may change and affect some of the details I present in this presentation. A warning, this incident occurred very quickly. It was violent, and it may be disturbing to some people that view and hear what I'm going to present today. I also have to explain that there is no video that captured the shooting deaths of Security Director Joe Zangiro and Bailiff Ron Kinzel. I would also like to echo what Sheriff Bailey explained, that the person responsible for these events is Larry Darnell Gordon. He's the perpetrator and sole actor, and the investigation has not led us to anyone else that had participated in any way to his actions. Once this investigation is complete, we will be turning over a copy to the Berrien County Prosecutor for review. Today I plan to show you two videos. One of the videos has sound. The video that has sound comes from courtroom 315, which was in session at the beginning of this event. I must also explain, as we listen to that audio, that it's oftentimes difficult to hear what's being said. Multiple people are talking at the same time. There's screams, there's yells, there's banging, there is gunshots, and it's often difficult to distinguish at times what's being said, and I plan on helping you out with that. I'm going to break the videos down into sections. Three sections I'm going to talk about as we work through this. I'm going to give you a little background first. The first video I'm going to play is the video and audio from courtroom 315. Larry Gordon was placed on the court list to be brought over to court on July 11th in the afternoon. Shortly before the video starts, Gordon was handcuffed and brought into the courtroom and placed in an area that wasn't recorded to wait for his turn. There was a short discussion that Bailiff Ron Kinzel had with the prosecutor, and they determined that Larry Gordon wasn't needed in court at that time. Bailiff Ron Kinzel motions to Deputy Atterbury that he's not needed and can be returned to the holding cell. And that kind of sets up where we're going to begin with the video. The faces have been redacted. And I believe, are we at roughly 219? All right, what you're seeing here is the video inside the courtroom of 315 on the third floor. This is where the defense attorney and prosecutor sit. This is kind of the behind them, and an individual is at the podium speaking with the judge. In this corner, you see Bailiff Ron Kinzel, and you'll be able to see Bailiff Ron Kinzel make a hand motion to Deputy Atterbury, who's positioned off view, that he can return Larry Gordon to the cell. Deputy Atterbury uses a door that's near the front of the courtroom that leads to a hallway back to the holding cells. At 2:19 and 33 seconds, you'll hear the attack on Deputy Atterbury to get his gun. The people in the courtroom will respond to that, and Bailiff Ron Kinzel will respond by running across the front of the judge's bench within a couple seconds to help Deputy Atterbury out. He'll then go through that same doorway, and when that doorway opens, on the audio, you'll hear, "No, no, no, don't shoot," followed by a gunshot. This startles everybody in the courtroom. And about 3 seconds later, there's another gunshot. The judge in this case tells everybody to get out of the courtroom. And people begin to file up, run out of the courtroom. One of the things that happens is the individuals on the right side podium, along with some of the people up front, leave immediately. The individuals on the left side in the pews initially hide. The fight continues, you can hear on the video. And we know Security Director Joe Zingiro responds to that area and calls to other bailiffs that he needs assistance, they need help on the third floor. Through records of his Crox key, electronic key, we know that he responds to that area to assist the hallway leading back to the holding cell, and at 2:19:58 hours, he activates and unlocks the door leading back to that area. And from a witness, is shot within seconds, fatally shot. We continue to hear banging and more gunshots, and a female in the courtroom instructs the individuals hiding on the left side that the judges ordered everybody to clear the courtroom, and everybody then leaves. As she's leaving, She's hearing shots fired and explains that, shots fired. I know that's a lot of information, but I want to explain that to you, and now what we're going to do is you're going to listen to what I explained up to that point. You're going to hear an individual yell, "He's got a gun." You're going to hear an individual say, "Please help me." You're going to hear a scream. You're going to hear responding bailiffs repeatedly yell commands to put it down, put the gun down. You'll hear Larry Gordon say, "I got hostages. I got hostages." There'll be a pause, and he'll explain that he's got 8 hostages. You'll hear him giving orders, "Open it up right now." He'll instruct one of the hostages to bring up a court sign that's been tipped over, pull it back behind where they're hiding, and begin to beat on a glass door and partition that's locked that leads to offices in a not a public area of the courtroom. You'll hear Larry Gordon yell, get in front of me, you get over there," directing the hostages where to stand. You'll continually hear commands from the bailiffs to drop the gun. We're going to end this section while he's commanding one of the hostages to break down the door, and you'll hear 5 distinct attempts to break through the glass door and partition, followed by a pause, followed by 9 more loud bangs. And we'll play the section now.
Thank you.
for this final section, you're going to hear Larry Gordon's escape plan changes since he hasn't been able to break down the door where he's located in a small hallway in the southeast corner of the building on the third floor. You'll hear Larry Gordon say, "Let's go this way. Follow in the line. Let's go." He continues by saying, "Let's go this way. No, this way," and makes reference to heading for some public stairs that are across the way from him in the southeast corner of the third floor. We also learn that one of the hostages has explained to him that even if he broke through that door, that doesn't lead to an exit. So he changes up his plan. After he crosses over, the bailiffs advance on him, and you'll hear two shots initially, followed by six shots, followed by a single gunshot, followed by commands to get on the ground, get on the ground. You'll hear two more gunshots and two more gunshots. We learn from the bailiffs that he's hit, Larry Gordon is hit at that point and falls back. We'll play the audio for you. Change the video to the video that we've collected that is outside the courtroom 315. It's like a lobby area. You exit the elevators on the third floors. There's like a bubble camera that shoots 360-degree direction. What we've done is divided that up into four different views, pointing at four different directions. This part of the video does not have audio. I'm going to explain and orient you to the views and what you're going to see in this first part, and I want to break this video down into three segments, too, that kind of correspond. Here you've got these views. This is looking north or towards the river. This is looking south towards Port Street. This is looking west towards the elevators or the lake. This is looking east. This is courtroom, the entrance to courtroom 315. You'll see here shortly, when the shots are initially fired, I explained that the people on the right side pews exit the courtroom initially while the people on the left side pews hide. When we start the video, you'll see people begin to exit out of the courtroom here, and the first group that exits from the right side pews finds their way off the floor and out of the area. A few seconds later, the people on the left side are told to leave the courtroom. And they leave and go to this back corner and hide around this back corner, which is in the southwest corner. You'll also notice, this is courtroom 327, that door will open, and a bailiff's gonna respond through the second group of people headed back to that corner to hide, make his way through them, and run to the file room door here in response to the call from security director Joe Zangaro that they need help on the third floor. When he gets to this door, he's gonna encounter a male in a green t-shirt that's not involved in this, that's just fleeing the file room area. And they're gonna kind of bump chest to chest, and the bailiff's gonna back up and kind of shut the door, and you're gonna see Larry Gordon run out handcuffed, holding a revolver in his right hand. You'll see the bailiff kind of swipe at his revolver, swipe at the firearm, and Larry Gordon will take off running down the lobby area. The bailiff will take cover in the doorway and draw his gun. The gentleman that the bailiff initially encounters in the green t-shirt also runs from here back to the same corner with the other seven people hiding. The gentleman in the green shirt knocks over that court sign right there as he runs around the corner, and Larry Gordon follows in the same path. The bailiff explains he considered firing at Larry Gordon as he fled with the handgun, but was concerned about his backstop. The bailiff then moves up to this position of cover, and you'll see three more bailiffs that are using the public stairwell through this hall enter. These bailiffs explain that they have saw Larry Gordon run across this opening with a gun, and they appear with their guns drawn. And they move down this side of the hallway. One of them moves kind of in the center to check this corner while this one is focused straight down the hall. And they end up in the entrance to courtroom 316 on the other side of the hall while this bailiff remains in that position. This position it would be. I think that's it for that. The individuals leaving the right side. Now the individuals leaving the left side of the courtroom, the doors open up here, the bailiffs getting through the people and responding to the file room door, runs into the gentleman in the green t-shirt. He runs past and knocks over this sign. There's Larry Gordon, fled the same direction. Now you'll see the bailiffs responding here. And you saw him just pull the sign back up there. I know this goes quick and I'm trying to point this stuff out, but they pulled the sign back to use it to beat the door there. And now we've got, why don't you stop it there? Now if you notice, another police officer has just come up this public stairwell here, and you'll see another courthouse employee in kind of a dress shirt also come up to assist. And they'll take cover positions north of the scene. They'll continue to issue commands. And the bailiff that's not visible here is going to decide to use his key and move through courtroom 316 to kind of flank and prevent the escape of the bad guy. When he's moving through the courtroom, the beating starts on the glass partition in the hallway. He believes that's gunfire and that they're shooting the hostages. He calls out to the others, active shooter. You'll see there's going to be a break, I guess, in the action I should address first. These cameras are motion activated by motion. And the bailiffs get in a position and they're issuing commands and there isn't any movement. So there is a skip in the video. Eventually what you're going to see is motion to pick the camera back up, and you're going to see a man and a woman exit from that southeast corner, and they kind of look like they're holding each other. And as they move down the hall or wall, they'll run forward, and there are two hostages that just run away and escape. The next object you're going to see is going to go pretty quick. And it's a female that was in the front row on the left side of the court. And she's wearing pants. And you can see Larry Gordon using her as a human shield behind her. And you can tell Larry Gordon, because he's got white socks on, he's left his shoes at another part of the building. And he uses her as a human shield and moves across from the southeast corner to the southwest corner to the southeast corner, and that happens quickly in about 3 seconds. Following Larry Gordon is another female wearing a dress, a male wearing a white t-shirt, and the male wearing the green t-shirt. And they're following behind per his instructions, and they're also saying to Gordon, let her go, let the female go. So you'll see him move across, and then them slowly move across. Finally, you'll see the gentleman that was standing at the podium with the burgundy shirt and a female with the pink dress up here in that corner, and again, they make a break for it and run away. The four individuals that have followed, three individuals that have followed along with Gordon. Gordon's got her in kind of a headlock, and he's got the gun to her head as he moves. I didn't tell you either, while he was in that back corner issuing commands, he would point the gun at all of them. What we're going to see is the bailiffs advance to cover positions and prevent his escape, and one of the bailiffs is going to explain how a shot opened up and he took the shot to save the hostage's life, and that's when the shooting started. Another bailiff began firing, and they continued to fire until he was no longer a threat. You'll see the bailiff that's flanked through the courtroom appear out of this hallway as the others advance. This officer is going to advance and meet up with him, and both of them are going to advance too. You're going to see the bailiffs get close, and some of them disappear in that corner and pull the gentleman out of that corner with a white shirt. You're also going to see the female in the dress run out of that corner, and you're going to see the officer pull the gentleman with the green t-shirt out too. And I kind of went out of order there, and I apologize. The first one to run out of the corner is the female that was held as the human shield, followed by the gentleman in the white shirt being pulled out, followed by the female in the dress running out, followed by the gentleman in the green shirt being assisted out and runs out. And you'll see them run back here. There's the first couple that disappeared, Gordon and the female, the three individuals behind. Now these two will exit and run out. Officers will advance, bailiffs. There's the female hostage that was held as a human. There's the bailiff that went through the courtroom. They're pulling the gentleman with the white shirt on. There's the female with the dress. Finally, the gentleman in the green shirt.